Spirit said something to me that almost made me cheer up. I said, the shout of a king is in this house. Watch. He said, that's why no matter how hard the enemy is fighting you, he will never win. Things I celebrate. God is in this house. I say, God is in this house. Amen. Lord, we give you praise. Thank you for your shout in this house. Thank you for your face beholding us. Thank you for the rain of your spirit that is empowering us. Thank you for your mercy and your grace, forgiving us our iniquities, strengthening us, empowering us. I thank you, Lord, now for strength going into every weak soul. Strength over every soul that discouraged. Strength. Hallelujah. If you are weak in your body, strength. Hallelujah. Strength, hallelujah. That's what he's giving me, strength. Strength, hallelujah. You're going to mount up with wings as an eagle. You're going to soar in Jesus' name. Lord, we give you the glory and the praise. May your face continue to shine upon us. Lead us into the blessing of this service. Thank you for a living word, a prophetic word, unction from the throne. We receive by faith and we give you praise in Jesus' name. God bless you. You may be seated. All right, Hebrews 4. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into his rest, although when to go, the works were finished from the foundation of the world. That is one scripture that keeps escaping us. He said, the works were finished. He didn't even say before you were born. He said, before? If nothing releases you into the rest of God, you can't get any better than that. So name anything in this room this morning. He said it was finished. Even before Satan started attacking, it was finished. Even before the problem arose, it was finished. Okay, now look at what he just said to me. He said, before you were born, I finished you. Your rebellion was an excursion away from my will, but as God, I have grace, power, and understanding how to work in your rebellion to fit my plan. Okay, now, you have to open up your spirit and you will come alive. Hallelujah. You have to know who you're dealing with. As I said that, the scripture popped. Look at it. Ephesians 1. Verse 7. This shows it to you. That's why what I'm about to read, when I see someone who is bitter about a past mistake or a past experience, I say it's because they're not in touch with God. You should be in awe and amazed how God has worked your mess to fit your life. But when you don't know that, you are bitter and angry and making noise and wasting precious time. You should be celebrating that you survived it. And now in your right mind, and God is about to do something new. Glory to God. Look at this. I'll read it to you so you can see. In whom we have redemption through his blood. He said, his blood paid for me. I didn't work my way to this place. He paid for it. Watch. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. He said, his grace is so wealthy that it accommodated everything I've ever done wrong. Hey, by the time I finish, your hallelujah will come alive. You know what you're shouting about. Watch, wherein he hath abounded. You know what an abound is? He said he had abound. He said he didn't just come trickling in. He said he came abounding to you. Okay. Watch, he says, wherein he had abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. He said he came with all the wisdom in the Godhead. Yeah. when he came to you and he grabs every area of your life and begins to work them into his plan. The challenge is you were rebellious before, but now we're dealing with your stubbornness. You wouldn't just let go. That's why I'm calling the message entering into the rest of God. Get out of the way. Watch. He abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. You notice? He said all these things God did in himself, within himself. You didn't make him. You didn't beg him. You didn't plead with him. You didn't even pray. You didn't seek him. He all decided this all by himself. What are you talking about? You brought nothing to the table. He said he purposed it in himself. Watch. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. You notice? That's what I've been preaching against all these years. He said he will gather all things in Christ. You can't be in anything else. You can't be in religion. You can't be in sororities. You can't be in fraternity. You can't be in your family. You can't be in anything but in Christ. That's your visa. That's your ticket. That's your passport. That's your breakthrough. I'm in Christ. Ooh, hallelujah. I am in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You see, I didn't do all of this for you to be identifying with your family instead of Christ. Identifying with this group or that group. He said, no, I'm only going to gather all things in Christ. That means Christ has to be number one. You can't be in anything else. Because all those organizations promise you a benefit. So when you go to court, you flash your sign and judge will let you off. You need a contract, you flash your sign. You are not in Christ. If you're depending on anything else but him. Hallelujah. Huh? You come into the realm of glory. That's why I will go to Missouri. And a man adjustment will agree to fly his airplane. And bring me back to Georgia. And drop it off. And go back by Delta. And I hadn't paid a dime. That's glory in Christ. Watch. If you are not in the glory, as soon as you walk up, he sees a black man. He sees a man that can't be trusted. He sees a man that's broke, that's probably come to, you know, run a game on him. But in Christ, he saw a man he can trust. You know how much airplanes cost? To fly your airplane to Atlanta, Georgia, and leave it with strangers, and go back to Missouri, and believe you're going to get paid. Woo, hallelujah. The miracles of my Father in Christ. In Christ. Outside of Christ, we have all kinds of limitations. But in Christ, all things are possible. If I believe. Some of you are struggling with these things. You don't know that you're like, that's why I preached last Sunday, the fight for the crown of life. You don't know what the fight is about. Watch. So I can get to my punchline and return to my text. He said that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven. So we know that the people that died in Christ are where? In heaven. Watch. And then he says, and which are on earth. So they don't care what the name of your church is, or what denomination you were born in, or who you associate with. He says, they will gather together things in Christ in heaven, things in Christ on earth. You don't see under the earth. There's nothing in Christ going. That's where hell is, in case you don't know the scriptures. He said, now, he says, even in him, in whom also we have obtained, we have obtained, we have obtained. We are not going to obtain. We have obtained an inheritance. Are you ready for my punchline? He says, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Come on. You are not shouting because you have not seen what I read. Eh? First he said the works were finished before the foundation of the world. He said now, you've been redeemed by his blood. And he has abounded to us in all wisdom and prudence. Why did he do that? Because he set my destination before I started. Are you ready? He set my, he said, you were predestinated. Your destination was set before you started the journey. Even though he knew all these things that are wrong. But the reason he can set my destination before I got started, he says, because he's able to work all things. He can fashion everything and make it fit the counsel of his own will. Now, did you get what I just told you? He gets everything about your life. All the mess, all the mammoning, all the papading, all the craziness. He said he works it in. And it fits his purpose. He fits his plan. That's why when I see a bitter Christian, you see, you don't know the kingdom you're in. Because what you're mad about, he worked it already. So you can understand what I'm about to go back and read. When you understand it, you change your thought life. Satan won't be playing all this and jumping up and down and making noise. Jesus said, I agree with your adversary. So he said, he's making noise. So, okay, I understand how you feel, but you don't make the decisions. I said, the last time I checked, you lost out and you have no way to come back. At least I have a way to come back. I can repent now and change sides. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See, he works everything according to the counsel. That's why you find that people that have gone out there and done all kinds of things, they end up always having a ministry in the direction of where Satan has done all the craziness. What is God trying to prove? He's saying, I'm going to put what ruled you, wasted you, defeated you, messed over you, I will put it under your feet, and you're going to go back in there and deliver people like you. Hey, who am I preaching to? This is resurrection. So what he's telling you, the thing was finished before the foundation of the world. So you can understand the depth of your faith will reach new depths, not new heights. Huh? When you begin to ponder God, ponder his wisdom, ponder what his wisdom has created, what he has already done. And what is your little life? Oh, he just answered the question for me. He says, you are being deceived by suffering. You expected that what you did won't cost anything. But it cost the blood of Jesus to redeem you. But you don't want to suffer for anything. You see, that's what's deceiving you. That's what Satan is dancing on. Amen. When you should have been saying, okay, I'm suffering. I understand. But I know it's only for a minute. That's what 1 Peter 5 says. He says, just for a minute, and he will come and establish me, strengthen me, watch this, and settle me. Yeah. Ooh, hallelujah. Yeah. You finally find your groove. Glory to God. He says, after you have suffered a while, you have to understand there are consequences to things. He forgives us, but he allows that suffering so that he can produce glory for you. Don't let suffering throw you. It's part of the lesson. We begin a new week with the same word as the previous week. You must enter into his rest if you believe. But beloved, this message took on a totally different direction. Two very powerful, pivotal truths. First, doesn't matter where you've come from. Doesn't matter what you had done. Doesn't matter what Satan has accomplished. He said that God sets your destination before you start the journey because he's able to work all things after the counsel of his own will. When you understand it, there's no reason to look back. There are no reason for regrets. Let him work it. Just as the disciples put the fish and the loaves into his hands because it was impossible to feed 5,000 with them, men alone. You need to put these sufferings and these experiences and these things that wounded you. Let him work it into his plan. Let him work it into his plan. That is your most powerful weapon against the enemy. Secondly, remember, suffering is part of the lesson. Suffering is the pathway to crowning. Suffering is a must. And I quoted that scripture in 1 Peter 5. After you have suffered a while, why are you struggling to believe? He said you've been deceived by suffering. You thought that the suffering meant that God hadn't answered, or that he will not keep his word, or he will not fulfill his promise. No, it's part of the process. It's part of the process. After you have suffered a while, he says he will make you perfect. You notice? There's no other way to make you perfect. He will make you perfect. He will strengthen you. He will establish you, and he will settle you. To him be all the glory forever and ever. I don't know if it's this message that I said it. It's that anybody preaching to you who does not include suffering as a legitimate part of Christianity is a liar and a deceiver. There is no such Christianity. It's fake. And as soon as the money is messed with, you would discover what happened to a lot of the people that were fellowshipping with the full gospel businessmen in the 70s and 80s. And they all came in with all their big checks and, you know, businesses and all of that. But when the trials hit, most of them evaporated. Many of them went into depression. Some went back to drugs. So all that grandstanding was all money. You have to make sure that your faith is solid, your faith is real. Your faith. The reason I am not afraid today is that I served God hungry. And he vowed to me that I'll never be hungry again. So I'm shouting, I'm standing on a solid ground. I'm serving him today, blessed. But I've already served him hungry, so I don't have to worry about hunger anymore. But when you have not been through anything, you are constantly afraid of returning to where you came from. Receive us today. Receive the word of resurrection. It's life. It's life-changing. It's transformational. It's a new beginning. Post-resurrection week, you're walking in the newness of resurrection. Have you planted your seed for this month? Have you given your covenant seed? Have you kept your promise to the Lord to support the voice of resurrection? Do it now. Don't delay. Do it now. Don't falter. Do it now. You will see a totally brand new future and year in 2024. Thank God for those of you that have trusted us and believed the word of resurrection and acted on it. We give God praise for you, and your testimony will live. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. See you tomorrow.